Okay, so today we will investigate in four topics. So the first one is higher order finite element method, which means I want to show you the basic concept, how you can construct basis functions of higher order. Then there will be a short introduction to function spaces, which is quite important if you go deeper to the finite element method. And I will just show you the properties there, what are the norms in the different spaces, for example, and what you have to fulfill that the function belongs to such a function space. And then a very important topic, but it will be also quite short here. Perhaps you have heard a little bit in mathematics, but I guess just if there was some course discussing in some detail partial differential equations. So when do we get the unique solution, which is quite important? It's more the job, I would say, of mathematicians. Anyway, it's good that we have some knowledge, and we will see a main problem we already have in electromagnetics using the magnetic vector potential. You know, it is not unique. And in our finite element program, we have implemented a special regularization to get this working. And so in this context, I will discuss it. And the last part, which could be a lecture by its own, is just to give you some information without any proofs. What are the a priori error estimates? So what can we expect when we refine the mesh, for example, how fast we converge to the correct solution? Okay, so for higher order finite elements, a very good motivation can be done when we consider the Helmholtz equation. Why? Because we model their waves, and wave propagations have, or at least the Helmholtz equation has, a very smooth solution for the acoustic pressure. And there it makes more sense to keep your mesh and increase the order of your basis function will be more efficient as refine and refine your mesh. What is always a good approach when you develop something is that you have a computational setup with an analytic solution. And what you see here is actual, let's say, from the geometric point of view, a channel. But since we excite here, it in a sense that on the whole phase on the left side, we prescribe the pressure to one, and to the right side of this channel, the pressure is zero. And overall, the surfaces, so the other four surfaces, we have homogeneous Neumann boundary condition. It is a 1D problem. So we just have actually a dependency on X. And that you can see here that we have this analytical solution depending on the wave number K. You know, the wave number K is just angular frequency over speed of sound. So it's 2 pi frequency over speed of sound. And it also clearly depends on the length of the channel. And a standard error computation is, as shown here, that you just take the difference between the finite element solution. So this H always gives us an indication that it is the finite element solution, because you know that H is also the notation for the mesh size. We know the analytic solution, so we can take the difference in each node to the analytic solution, square it, and sum it over all finite element nodes. And then we, as you can see here, we also normalize it to the analytical solution and take the square root. And if you multiply it with 100, you get error in percentage. But please consider it is the accumulated error. So because we have the sum over all finite element nodes, it's not the error within one finite element node. And that is also a standard in measuring the error is that you really compare it in each finite element. Okay, what we get here, you have to take care. What we see here is the accumulated error, but the logarithmic scale. However, if you look here towards the number of unknowns, well, it is not very promising. It is a kind of a reduction we have here, which is an algebraic reduction. And especially what we see is important noted here. When you increase the wave number, then you also see that you have a worse error behavior, and it looks like in this logarithmic scale that you refine and refine your mesh, but the improvement gets very small. Okay, and that can be shown. This is a short summary of a very famous publication by Mark Ainsworth, who could show the following. So first of all, he used as an error norm, which we will also learn today, where he just compared not the computed value itself, the physical quantity, which is the acoustic pressure, but the derivative. Yeah? And that is clearly even more strictly to do this, because if you have a numerical solution and you compute a derivative, you almost lose one order of accuracy. So this is a very restrictive error norm. The important point is that one can show that the overall error can be decomposed in the interpolation error and the pollution error. Now, what you can see here, the interpolation error for us is something which is okay, because this theta here is wave number multiplied by the mesh size, which means when you increase the wave number, you decrease the mesh size and you can control this error. Yeah. On the other hand, we have this second term here, where you see that this is k multiplied by theta squared, which means it is proportional to k to the power of 3 and h to the power of 2. So that means you cannot control this error by refining your mesh, because k has a power of 3 and your discretization parameter h just a power of 2. Pollution error means that when you compute the wave propagation, then you will see that actually you get a wrong wavelength. As you know, the wavelength lambda is the fixed value speed of sound over frequency, and you excite with the frequency and 1 kilohertz or whatever, then you can compute this wave number analytically, but you will see that the numerical wave number will differ from this value. And that is especially a dominating error when the frequency and therefore the wave number is increased and increased. So for high frequency wave propagation, this is a big problem. And as we see, we cannot control this error by mesh refinements. On the other hand, he could show this very famous formula, where p here is the order of your basis function, h again here is the mesh size, and please note that when you fulfill this inequality, it doesn't mean that you have an accurate solution. But what it means is that when you fulfill it, then when you further increase the order of the basis function or decrease the mesh size, you get a monotonically reduction of the error. And that is important. So that means you have to fulfill this inequality, and then you are within a region concerning your order of basis function and mesh size, where you know when you now start and further decrease the mesh size or increase the order, you are sure that you will reduce the error. In the region before, it could be when you decrease the mesh size that the error is getting smaller. You further decrease the mesh size and the error is going up. So you are not in a convergent region, and that has to be fulfilled. And that is fulfilled when you, in this case, fulfill this inequality. Now, when we have a look here to this error plot, then you see the following. We have here the error on this axis and here the number of unknowns. Since we increase the order of the basis functions, your mesh keeps the same, but the number of unknowns increases because you increase the order of the basis function. And what we see here for the first part, and there is one mistake, so this blue should be also here, so that should be blue. That has the smallest frequency or smallest wave number, and you see immediately when we increase from order 1 to order 2, we decrease the error. So we are really already in this convergent region. However, somewhere we get to saturation, and that is due to the precision of your CPU. And you see it is about 10 to the power of minus 4, but it is just due to the fact that it is accumulated error. It is not the error in one finite element node. The same holds true still for this wave number. You see the green one, you immediately decrease here. And then you would see if you further go up, you will also here somewhere saturate. And what is interesting is for the highest wave number, we have not a real decrease from first order to second order. So here we have not fulfilled this inequality. So you see still 2p plus 1 is smaller than this term here. And then we fulfill our inequality as shown here. And we get a decrease in the error when we increase the order of the basis function. Okay, so this is a very practical equation here, because also the constant being in here can be set to 1 for practice. So we know everything. We know the order of the basis functions we are using. We know the wave number because we know the frequency in the waves, and we know h, which is the mesh size. Okay, so you know that the concept of the finite element method, which is a very complex method, if you compare it to finite difference, right? It is very easy how to get all the entries of your system matrix. But for the finite element method, well, you know, we always have this mapping here, and this mapping to the reference element is very, very important, because that allows us to define the basis function in the reference space with the coordinates psi and eta. And it also simplifies heavily when we do the integration and so on. So this is a very important concept. But this also helps us a lot concerning the basis function, because we can define them on the reference element and not on any shaped element we really have in our computational domain. And here you see the first order quadrilateral element. And let's have a look on this part here. And actually, the basis functions can also be generated by a tensor product of first order basis functions. Yeah? So you know, for first order, we have such a basis functions when we have here minus 1 and here plus 1 and here is psi, then the first basis function is like this, and the second basis function is like this. So that is n2 and that is n1, and what we have here is n of xi. So we know that the basis function here would be ni as a function of xi 1/2 1 plus xi I xi, and you know this xi I takes on the value plus minus 1. The same you can do for the second direction. Yeah? So we can do the same for ni as a function of eta, yeah, which is the second coordinate, and there we just have the same, but now with eta. So it is 1/2 1 plus eta I eta, and we know this eta I also takes on the value plus minus 1. And now you see, when you multiply these two, meaning you take a tensor product, because they are actual orthogonal, the two directions, you come up exactly to this basis function for a two-dimensional quadrilateral. And you come up to the hexahedron when you take now your third direction and use there the same basis function, and then just multiply it with the third direction, which would give you 1 over 8, and then the multiplication of the three terms, which are the three one-dimensional basis function actually you have multiplied. Okay, so you see, this is the standard machinery, which means we can reduce our investigation to construct appropriate 1D basis functions. And by the tensor product, we get 2D or 3D basis function for at least quadrilateral and hexahedral elements. And there is a special transformation called Duffy transformation, where you then get from a hexahedron a tet or a pyramid or a wedge element or whatever you want. So you see, we have a full machinery within the finite element method, which is then at the end based on this tensor product. And what is our job is to investigate in 1D basis functions. And when we use the standard basis function, which are Lagrange polynomials, then, and they are defined by this formula here, perhaps you know it, pi, this capital pi just means the product, what you set up, there you see, you get the Pete order basis functions if you go up to P. And first order, as we see here, means exactly what I just have shown here. This is the first basis function, and that is the second basis function. Now, if, and what is very important, and that is the nice thing here, is that we have always this delta property, which we also have forced, that at a specific node, which will be a specific degree of freedom within your computational domain, one basis function is equal to one there and all others are zero. This is the so-called delta property. Now, when we want to go from first order to second order, it's clear we need three basis functions. But what happens, and that is the important point we have to realize, what happens is that we have here new basis functions. So the first two basis functions, they are not incorporated in the next level. And you also see, if we go to third order, we have now four basis functions, but this four basis function doesn't correspond somehow to the basis function we had at second or first order. So we will always get new basis function, which is not a hierarchic structure, but it also has some advantages, and they are used. We also have implemented, if you go, you use our higher order capabilities, you can choose between this Lagrange basis function and the next one I will show you, them will be the Legendre basis function. A disadvantage why we are not really using it heavily is that there is no mixing allowed in 2D or 3D between neighboring elements. So you cannot say element one has order two and the neighboring element has order three. Did this not working? And that was original, the starting in the 1990, why some scientists developed non-conforming grids. So they actually had a conforming grid from the mesh generator, but they wanted to use different orders of finite elements at different locations, and the neighboring elements cannot have this when you use Lagrange basis function. However, if we use Legendre basis function, and especially the so-called integrated Legendre basis function, then we have this important property that these basis functions are hierarchic. So, and that you can see on the right hand side, if we look here, then you see, well, for first order, we have the same basis function. It's if you use Legendre or Lagrange. But if you go now from first order to second order, and that you see is nice, the first two basis functions we had here for first order, you see it also, they are within second order. You just get the additional basis function here, and so we have this hierarchic property. And you also see it if you then go to the next order, which would be third order here, you see that all basis functions of second order remain, and we get just here this basis function n4 in addition. However, a disadvantage which you can resolve, but the disadvantage is that this delta property for a standard stiffness matrix is just fulfilled in 1D, but in 2D or 3D it is not fulfilled. So we need there some additional additional post-processing actually. So for the solution it is not a problem, but when you do post-processing, then clearly you that is a little bit more involved. Okay, so you see we have now the machinery how to come up to higher order basis function, because we do this on this 1D level and then use the tensor product. What we also see here for this Legendre basis function we have here is that now we can mix, yeah, that you can see. Now you can really mix from one finite element to the next finite element. You can immediately change the order of your basis functions, and that is working, and that is because we have this hierarchic property. What we and also perhaps what I should tell you is we have a better condition for our system matrix at the end than when you use Lagrange elements. However, but that is also clearly the case for Lagrange elements. Whenever you use higher order basis function, the computation of the matrix itself needs more computational power, and the number of non-zero entries in your system matrix is strongly decreasing. Yeah, so we get the system matrix with more non-zero entries, which means the algebraic solution process with a direct solver, iterative solver, will be higher and so on. So there is always a trade-off. If you have the following goal that you want to achieve some specific accuracy as fast as possible, yeah, then it makes no sense to use very high order of basis function. Then perhaps it makes sense to use third order basis function, or sometimes even with second order basis functions, you get for this accuracy the fastest solution. Okay, now if we look a little bit to a hexahedron, clearly we have now degrees of freedom at the vertices. So what I have shown here with this tensor product is actually what you get there are the basis functions at the vertices. We clearly also have need edge basis functions. So this is a basis function along the edge, as you can see here. It is zero here at these three edges, and here you see it is different from zero. And that you get when you evaluate this formula here, yeah, as you can see here. And then we also have to consider bubble functions. Bubble functions, as we can see here, are on the face of an element. And the nice thing here, as you can see here, at the edges, it is already zero. And the last one are interior function, which means on all surfaces of your hexahedron, this function is equal to zero, which means it has no actual coupling to degrees of freedom of a neighboring function. And so you could already do a static condensation and get rid of this unknowns and still have the property of high order. Okay, so you see, this is a little bit more involved when you then go to 2 and 3D. As you see, we then will not only have the unknowns at the vertices, as we see here, you also introduce unknowns at the edges and on the within surfaces and within the element itself with interior functions. Okay, so this should just be a small introduction to finite element methods with higher order basis functions, so that you just see that there is a machinery behind. We have to take care clearly for some situations, and but before, I also want to show you this important property that actually we have three directions at the reference element, which is xi, eta, and theta. And you can use, for example, different orders in the different directions, which is quite interesting. It's not necessary that you use the same order in the same direction, and that is especially helpful for computational mechanics. So if we have, like here, a plate structure which is very thin, and you look here at the mesh, well, then you will have a strong aspect ratio in thickness direction towards the element sizes we have here, yeah, and here you have very small elements. And so it makes sense if you use a coarse grid that you use lower order basis function in thickness direction, and in the other two direction, in our case, it would be the xi and eta direction, we use higher order basis function so that we get somehow an equivalent approximation of this structure. So this is then called the anisotropic PFEM. And so you see, you also have this degree of freedom to go towards a method where you use different orders in the different directions. Yeah, here are some examples now when we use such a tensor product space in 2D. So we have here the order for the xi direction, for the eta direction, and you see we have then here nothing else as in each direction 1 xi, xi squared, xi to the power of 3, 4, and so on, and the same for eta. And we have all the mixing terms in here. And on the bottom here, you see how these basis functions look like. We call these mode shapes. And these are our standard basis function of first order. And so you see for the different orders in xi and eta direction how they look like. And here we can nicely also see when we use anisotropic PFEM, for example, we go to higher order in xi direction and we stop at second order for eta direction, then we just take out these basis functions. Okay. What is important when you now really change from element to element? The basis functions, it is the following. You should apply the minimum rule. The minimum rule means you look at two neighboring elements. You see here, let's first look here. You see you have here fourth order and here sixth order. So at this edge, you have to keep the order for the basis function coming for both elements to 4, because this is the minimum between 4 and 6. And you even see here now this special case. In this element, we have an anisotropic PFEM. So as you see here, in this direction, we use fifth order. So here we have sixth order. So we use along this edge fifth order. Between these two elements, this is a standard finite element of first order. Here is an anisotropic PFEM finite element. And in this direction here, we have second order, we have here first order. So along this edge, we have to take then the case of second order. So this is what you have to fulfill. And since these basis functions need to get a orientation when you just put them together, as shown here, you have to introduce a so-called global edge orientation in order that when you then compute the element matrices and assemble it to the system matrix, that this global edge orientation is fulfilled, which means, for example, when the local edge orientation is in this direction, here in this direction, the global is in this direction, you don't have to do anything on this element, but on this element, the basis function along this edge, you have to multiply with minus 1, because the global ordering is taken here. How you take the ordering globally is up to you. It just has to be consistent throughout the computational mesh. And that is what really happens is, if you don't take this into account, then you would, for example, add entries of the element matrix to the system matrix, where along this edge they have different ordering, and then you get a wrong approximation by the basis function along this edge. If you keep it, you see, you just multiply this with minus 1, then you get a correct 1 as shown here. Okay, and as I have told you, the special transformation is the so-called Duffy transformation. So you have then any order for your hexahedron, and you can make out of your hex element a dead element or a pyramid or a wedge element by this Duffy transformation. So you set up all your basis function for a hex element, and by the Duffy transformation you get also higher order basis functions for triangles in 2D, that's wedge elements or pyramids in 3D. Okay, so here you see that this gives you then the possibility that especially for partial differential equation, you are solving this definite element method having a smooth solution, so you have no singularities within your computational domain, then the more efficient way from the theoretical point of view is to keep the mesh and increase the order of the basis function. From the practical point of view, we always have to be careful because the higher the order, the more non-zero entries in the system matrix we have. And we know we also have to solve for the algebraic system of equations at the end. And so you will have at the end the trade-off between the mesh size, h, and the order of the basis function. However, what is very nice is especially when you have adaptive finite element methods, which means you have a first computation and then with error estimators, you automatically can check for each element if you should refine it. Then it is also a possibility instead of refining at these regions and making a finer mesh, you can also increase the basis function there. So you keep for the whole computational domain your mesh, but you increase individually for those elements where the error is not accurate enough, just the basis function. So that is also a nice approach in practice. Okay, the second topic where I want to give a short introduction, function spaces. I think at least the L2, also called the Lebesgue space, you already have heard. But that is too less for us because we have derivatives, and so we also have to define that derivatives also have a finite value. So first of all, we need the definition of the derivative of order alpha, and you write this with capital T exponent alpha operating on your unknown V, and you see you compute this derivative in this form here, where the order here of alpha is computed as a sum of all alpha I. So this is very abstract. So let's look as an example. We have alpha, for example, we have here, let's say V is a function of two coordinates, x1, x2. So it could be xy. But it's easier to use x1, x2 so that we can use index notation. Then if alpha in this sense is for x1, 2 and for x2, 0, it means it's the second, here, it's the second derivative of this function with respect to x1. If we have then this pair, for example, then it is clear that it is the second derivative. Yeah, you see, there is always the maximum what we have, which is computed by this formula. So it's a second derivative with respect to x1 and x2. Yeah. And then it's logically that for the pairing 0 and 2, it's the second derivative of our function with respect to the second coordinate x2. Okay, a first definition which is important is functions which are continuously differentiable. So we call here this function space mainly with C, and the exponent shows us to which order of derivative we get a continuously function again. Okay, so it is the following. So this is a collection of all functions v in our computational domain, where we project this function from our space to the real numbers. When we apply this derivative of order alpha to this function here, and it is still a continuous function, yeah, because it is within C. So we have no jumps within this function here. A special property is, or a special function space is C infinity, and this is a function space where we have infinitely often continuously differentiable functions, for example, a sine or a cosine function, or an exponential function. You can do infinite differentiations. Each of these differentiations will still give a continuous function. So in German, continuous is stetig. Und differenzierbar is smooth. Okay, let's have a simple example like shown here. So this example is now shown here in within, let's say, the domain, which is just one coordinate x between, let's say, 0 and 3. And it looks like a quadratic function, not fully smoothly, because if you take the first order derivative, this function has a kink here, but it is clearly continuous. Yeah? However, when you do a second derivative, we get this jump here. And the question is, what is the value at x equal to? So this is, in the classical sense, no function anymore. And that means this example is an example for a C1 function, because we just can't perform one derivation on this function and still get a continuous function. Yeah, an important space, as I already told at the beginning, are square integrable functions. We call this the so-called L2 space or Lebesgue space, which means that when you integrate this function, you take the square of the function, or the absolute value, and then square it, then you integrate over your computational domain, and still what you get out is smaller than infinity. So you see, this is then the typical definition, as the mathematicians do. So if you look at such a function, this is a function, yeah, because we define it as shown here. So we define that at position equal x equals 0, it has the value 0. Yeah? So that perhaps I have to put here, this is then the value at x equals 0. Yeah, and clearly such a function belongs to the L2 space, but please be careful, we have to restrict the domain of the L2 space. If you would take a L2 space of an infinite domain omega, then clearly we will not fulfill that the square of this function integrated will be smaller than infinity. But as you know, mostly we clearly deal with finite domains. Okay, now a very important thing within the finite element method is, and I'm not sure if you already have heard it, is weak derivative. Do you know this definition, or have you ever heard of a weak derivative? Schwache Ableitung. Okay, no. Great. In which course would be interesting for me? Do you remember the course where you heard this? Ah, okay. Yeah, okay, that's clear. Okay, but anyway, You do not hear this within a mathematical course, or so in, I think you have mathematics 1, 2, and 3 in your curriculum. I guess you don't hear it. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Then it's just a summary. A simple idea how to explain it to you is the following. What you know is, I always told you we can use this kind of hot functions, yeah, for approximating our unknowns. But if you take a derivative in the strong form of such a hot function, it is not working, yeah, because if you take a derivative, you don't get out anymore a function, because at position x equal 0, we will have the classical jump. But as you know, we first transform the partial differential equation into a weak form, and then you have something like I have shown here. We are interested in the weak derivative of this function u, and we multiply it with a smooth function, yeah, which is this here, where we know that this function at the limits -1 + 1 is equal to 0. Okay, so it means now we have here line which is has a positive slope, here a negative slope. So we integrate from -1 to 0, and our function u is x + 1, and from 0 to 1 the function is 1 - x. Now when you apply a integration by parts, so from here to here it is a integration by parts, then we have the following. We know we need here the derivative, which is 1, but you know it is always minus the integral plus then the evaluation of the functions at the boundaries, because we are in 1D, so it is, we have no additional surface integral, that is why this minus is coming in. And that is why I have written here explicitly this +1. Yeah, the derivative of u here is +1. And then we have this term here, which we have to evaluate. So it is the, instead of phi prime, the derivative, we have phi multiplied by our function u to be evaluated at -1 and 0. And when we look here into integration by parts, then the derivative is -1, as explicitly shown here. And we have here our function multiplied by phi, because we have here the derivative, and to be evaluated at the limits 0 and 1. If we now combine these two, it is exactly what we have here. And the nice thing is, if you look here, then since phi at -1 is 0, it just keeps phi at 0, and that is exactly here. The same holds true for here, because phi at 1 is 0, so we have just to evaluate phi at 0, and so you see this just cancels out. And what remains is this part here, which I have rewritten here. So we see this very important thing, which is here and here, which is actual our u prime. So I have rewritten it. That was our hot function, and the weak derivatives are now defined as shown here. It is 1 between -1 and 0, and between 0 and 1, it is -1. Okay, so you see again this important thing, that we have here not a discretization of the strong form, but of the weak form, and therefore we have also this kind of weak derivative, and we can use this first order function, basis function, hot functions, in order to approximate our physical quantities in the different partial differential equations. Okay, now what are the properties our functions have to fulfill? And we collect them in a function space. We already have discussed this continuously differentiable function space, this CM, which is differentiable up to order m. Now here we need a little bit more, and that are the classical Sobolev spaces. They are defined as follows. We have two important parameters. They are always, or mainly if you look at any mathematical book, it is denoted by W, and they have two values, this P and this M. And you see the P you get again within the space L space, which is the Lebesgue space. We just have defined the L2 space, and P could be also 1. It would be the L1 space for 2 L2 space. It could be also a higher order value. So first of all, the function has to be within this special Lebesgue space defined by P. The order is defined by P. And then in addition, the weak derivative up to order alpha, as we have seen here, which is limited by M. Now you see why we have here the second parameter. They are again in this Lebesgue space. So what we force is that the function itself is in this Lebesgue space, and all the derivatives up to this order M are also in this Lebesgue space. And each space clearly needs a norm, and we just differ between the classical norm and the semi-norm. We already had both norms today when we were discussing about the errors within our simple wave propagation problem in this channel. So the classical norm, as you have seen here, is defined by this equation, and the so-called semi-norm is defined by this equation. And you see the difference once the measure has to be smaller equal m, and here it is totally equal to m. And we just will have an example so that this gets clear, but if you use the rules as explained, you can explicitly then write down for a function space with any value of p and any value of m how you compute the norm and the semi-norm. And what we are mainly using is the Hilbert space. It is a Sobolev space, but the main property is that we are looking for functions in L2. Yeah? And they have any order of weak derivatives up to order m, as you can see here. Okay, so if we are now looking to an example, to make it not too complicated, that is the classical H1 space. So you see the full norm is that you take the function squared, integrate over the computational domain as shown here, and take the derivative, square it, and integrate here over the computational domain, and at the end you take the square root. Yeah? If we go back, you also have seen p. Here you have to take it to the power of 1 over p. If p is 2, it's the classical square root. And you see the semi-norm was exactly also what I have shown you today, which is more restricted because you are not looking how accurate your solution is, but you are looking at the derivatives of your solution, yeah? Which would be the fluxes, for example. For us, for example, you are not looking directly at the magnetic vector potential, for example, you are looking at the magnetic flux B, which is the curl of A. And the inner product, you always also need the inner product. You write it in this form. you see the inner product between two functions in such a function space is just the multiplication of the function integrate over the computational domain and take the derivatives, multiply them and integrate over the domain. Okay, so this is also the space which is actually more or less we have discussed. The only exception again is electromagnetics, where we have not the classical H1 space, but you have it for the heat equation, you have it for electrostatics, you have it for the mechanical equation, you have it for the acoustic equation, and so on. But for the magnetic vector potential, we will also shortly discuss, you need this special H curl. Okay, so now going towards the unique solution, here I just want, or I have just summarized it as the mathematicians write a weak formulation. They write it in this sense. What is given? It is given an excitation, which is the right-hand side, and any material parameter C in the whole computational domain, and they are real values. And now you want to find the solution U in a function space Vg such that for all V, which are our test function, in another function space called V0, fulfill this equation here. And this is typically, you call this a bilinear form, and you write it in this sense. So this is the bilinear form, and you call this the linear form. Because as you see here, we have your test function unknown. Here we just have the test function and the given right-hand side. And how you compute the bilinear and linear form is shown here. That is classically, so it was actually a Laplace equation with some additional term, where we also have here our parameter C. So if we would go back here to the, perhaps that is interesting, I have not shown, if you would go back, that would be minus the Laplacian of U plus C U is equal to F. Yeah? That would be the partial differential equation. And as a boundary condition, we have U equal G on the whole boundary gamma. So that is our strong form. Okay, and this is, as we know, it is just written here, as you will also find in mathematical books, and that is the linear form. And now this function space Vg, where we are searching for the solution, is the standard H1 space, as we already have discussed. So the functions have to be in L2, and the first order derivative, weak derivative, also in L2. And in addition, it has to fulfill that it is equal to the value g on the boundary. And for the test function, we have the function space V0. Always when you have a homogeneous boundary condition, you mainly call, or you have as an index for such function spaces, the zero. So V0 needs also functions which are within H1, and they are equal to zero on the boundary. Classical, as we have discussed, on the Dirichlet boundary, the test function should be zero because we already know the unknown physical quantity, in our case, U. And now the definition without any proofs. When do we get a unique solution? And this is already for the weak form. So the first of all is the definition of a continuous bilinear form. So this bilinear form is continuous, and clearly also continuous means also bounded. We have finite values. If this inequality is fulfilled. So the bilinear form of two functions, as we have here, take the absolute value, I have to take the laser pointer, is always smaller or equal when you just take the norm of V. Yeah? And V is any function. W would be, for example, our interesting function, and that is within the function space. Yeah, there I should have written clearly, I have forgotten H1, I should write here. Okay, so this is a continuous function. When does the bilinear form is coercive? And that is an important property. And that is something which we will not fulfill without any additional kind terms concerning the magnetic vector potential. A bilinear form is coercive now, as you can see here, if this is fulfilled. Yeah? So if you put into the bilinear form the function V, then this should be always greater or equal as if you would take here our norm of this function in the according space. Okay, now I see I have used any standard space H, and as an example H1, which means I should put this H1 here away. Okay, so that has to be fulfilled, and we will see for our magnetic vector potential weak formulation we have in electromagnetics, this is not fulfilled. So we have to do some kind of coaching. And then we have the important Lex-Milgram theorem, and that tells us if we have a given Hilbert space, a continuous coercive, and that is important, bilinear form, and the continuous linear form, there exists a unique solution such that our weak formulation is fulfilled. And that is for us also clearly extremely important, then we know we have a unique solution. And you see a very, very important property is this coercivity. Okay, now coming back to our simple weak formulations we had before, as you can see here, I just have rewritten it here. We see a very important property which can be shown very easily, this proof. So since I have put here the H, it means it is already the discrete weak form. Yeah, because we have already put in our approximation. And now when you do the following, we subtract the continuous weak form from the discrete weak form and use this property. You know, we introduce any test function. So our discrete test function could be also chosen as they would be the continuous one. And you subtract now the continuous weak form from the discrete weak form. Then the right-hand side, as shown here, cancels out. And you can combine your solution U, the analytic solution, and the discrete solution here in the bilinear form, and you see that this is equal to zero, which means at the end, and that is very important, that UH, our discrete solution, is the best approximation we can get. And that makes also the finite element method so attractive, because due to this property, when we fulfill all the things like coercivity and so on, then the solution we get is the best approximation we ever can get. That doesn't mean that it's the fastest one at the end, what you get or whatever, but it means compared to accuracy, it will be always the best one. And that is clearly a great property. Okay, now let's apply these simple definitions here and show that especially coercivity, that we have a problem with our magnetic vector potential. So what you see actually here is the weak formulation for magnetostatics written for the vector potential. And here perhaps you see this so-called H curl space. So this is also written, we could write that this is, it is mostly written as H curl. So you see it is perhaps a difficult space, but with the definitions we already know, the functions have to be in L2. This exponent 3 just means we are in 3D. And not only the functions, but also the curl of the functions has to be in L3. And if you take on your boundary, the cross product with the normal component of this function, then it should be zero, which is defined then in a discrete setting by definition by the edge elements. Okay, so this is our partial differential equation. And now we really have a problem, because when you put in here in the bilinear form, well, this is the bilinear form, a vector which is generated by the gradient of a scalar, then we know that the gradient, that the bilinear form is zero, because the curl of a gradient is always zero, which means that this is smaller as taking the gradient of the scalar function, the norm, in this space, what we have defined here. So you see the coercivity is not fulfilled. And that we also know that we can put any gradient function to it, get a new vector potential, so we have no unique solution. And what we do is, so you can do a column gauging, clearly, as you perhaps have heard in other courses, but what we do is a mass regularization. What does means the mass regularization? To our standard term, which we have here, you put this so-called mass term. So you see, you put this term with a parameter epsilon. And clearly epsilon should be small compared to our reluctivity, which is in our original bilinear form. What we clearly have to prove is that this perturbed vector potential, let's call it A epsilon, converges to the correct vector potential in the limit when epsilon going to zero. Then we have everything fulfilled, because with this additional trick we have done here, we will have a coercive bilinear form. So now, how do we proceed? When we subtract this perturbed bilinear form, A epsilon, I go back, this A epsilon means that we also take this additional term in the bilinear form, and we subtract it from the original one, then we result in this part here. The right-hand side, as we know, is not of interest. We are just looking at the bilinear forms. And I have also put in here A minus A perturbed, which is coming from this bilinear form. And you know, in addition, we clearly also have this term here coming from this bilinear form, because you compute A minus A epsilon. Now, what we can rewrite is the following, that you rewrite this as A epsilon minus this term here, which means that the perturbed bilinear form where now also A is included, is equal to this value here. Yeah, this is very important. So this is a simple bilinear form which is giving us a mass matrix, but now epsilon is in front of this bilinear form. And if you use now the so-called Friedrich's inequality that is just estimates, then we get the following. What we want to estimate is what is the difference between the original vector potential and the perturbed one. And you have this Friedrich's inequality that when you take this in the L2 norm, then this is smaller or equal this part here, because we put here in addition the L2 norm of the curl of the difference between vector potential, the original one, and the perturbed one. And that can be also rewritten instead of the L2 norm with the H1 norm, because we know the L2 norm of this difference is the standard L2 norm. In the H1 norm, we also have to take the derivatives into account. And this part, what we have here, is then smaller or equal, or has to be, as our perturbed bilinear form is written here, yeah, of A minus A perturbed and A minus A perturbed. Now, what we can do here is the following. We have computed this important relation, which I have rewritten here. And now we can express here this part, which means at the end that this can be inserted here. This was our original norm, where we want to get the estimate. So you see it again here. And so you see that the difference between A and this perturbed vector potential in the L2 norm is smaller or equal, yeah, as we have seen here by this idea. We now can put this in here as this part here. And clearly, if epsilon is going to zero, this part is going to zero, which means also this part has to go to zero, which means A is really approaching the perturbed vector potential A epsilon. Okay, so this is actually what we do in our source code, so we don't have to introduce an additional unknown which you need for the Coulomb gauging. And as you see, the important part here is to have this Alex Milgram theorem, and to see then that our standard bilinear form in the magnetostatic case doesn't fulfill the coercitivity, so we cannot have a unique solution. By this trick here, we get a unique solution. Clearly, epsilon has to be small compared to our material, physical material parameter reluctivity. But if this is the case, then we could show that this perturbed vector potential really converges to the original one. Okay, and as a final slide, I have again some definitions, but that should help you in practice to get a priori error estimate. So that means, what can we expect when we refine our computational mesh? How much better our solution will go? And for this, we have to read this theorem. So we have a bilinear form which is continuous, coercitive, so we have a unique solution. And the solution U is within a space HR, and that is the solution of the strong form. Yeah. So for example, if we have such a partial differential equation, minus Laplace U is equal to F, then U has to be at least within the space H2. Yeah, and that could also that we have to fulfill some boundary conditions. But as you see, we have a second space derivative, so we need at least functions with a second derivative, otherwise it's not working. Okay, so then if we have this property that we have a continuous coercive bilinear form and our solution U is in HR, then there exists a discrete solution with a constant independent of the solution, which is also important, and the discretization parameter, so C is really a constant, that this equation is fulfilled. And here, what is very important is to notice we look for the difference between the analytic solution and the numerical solution, which is UH, in this norm HM, where M is the order of the weak derivatives. Yeah? So you see, to make it already clear, we have this Poisson equation as shown here. And for the Poisson equation, we know that when we go to the weak derivative, then the order of the derivative is just one. However, in the strong form, the solution has to be in H2, so R is 2, and K are the order of the basis functions. And now, for this explicit part, you also see that we have here an alpha. And the alpha is evaluated here by taking the minimum between k plus 1 minus m. K is the order of our basis function. M, as we know, is the order of the weak derivatives in the weak formulation. And R is the order of the space we need in the strong formulation. And then we have this a priori error estimates, which tells us when we measure the difference between the analytic solution and the numerical solution in the H1 norm, then this is smaller or equal to any constant, then the discretization parameter up to alpha, and then the absolute value of the analytical solution in H2. The important parameter here, or important term here, is how this scales with the mesh size. And it scales with the mesh size H to the power of alpha. And here is alpha. Now, if we look here, K is equal to 1, and M is equal to 1. So we have k plus 1 is 2, minus 1 is 1. R is 2, 2 minus 1 is 1. So what we get here is then at the end, what we can write here, that is still with alpha, that this is proportional to h. Yeah? So you have a linear convergence, how you reduce your error in the H1 norm. So that means for your fluxes, for the derivatives, if you directly measure your physical quantity, the electrostatic potential, for example, in a finite element computation, then we get here this important term where we have h to the power of 2 times alpha, which means for us h squared. Yeah, that is nice because if h is reduced by a factor of 2, so in each direction you refine your mesh with a factor of 2, then the error reduces by a factor of 4, as we see here. Yeah, because we have here h squared. But please consider your fluxes. Yeah, for example, for us, the electric field then has just a reduction by 2. Yeah, so you reduce the error just by 2 when you refine the mesh in both directions by a factor of 2. Then you get a reduction in the error by 1/2, but 1 over 4 for the scalar potential itself, for the physical quantity. Yeah, clearly, as always, this is not general. So it depends also a little bit on the smoothness, also we call it regularity of your computational domain and the solution U, so that at the end alpha could also be a little bit smaller than 1, but for our standard approaches, so that is just the case when you have somewhere singularities. But let's assume we do not have singularities, then alpha approaches 1. And then we have here this rule of thumb for the a priori error estimate. And so you know how your error decreases when you decrease the mesh size, when you refine your mesh. And that is almost for all partial differential equations we have discussed. When we have no singularities there, then by refining the mesh with a factor of 2 in each direction, then you reduce approximately the error by 1 over 4. Okay, so this was a short summary concerning a priori error estimates, which is at the end, if you do real simulations and you want to have an idea about the accuracy, an important result to know how you can reduce the error or by which amount the error is reduced when you refine your mesh. And we also have seen the importance of this coercivity of a bilinear form in order to have a unique solution. For all our PDEs, we have discussed that there was no problem, just for the PDE concerning electromagnetics with the vector potential, we have this non-uniqueness, and there we are not coercive, and we have to treat this problem also when we do numerical computation, not only on the analytical side, where we discussed about Lorenzo-Coulomb coaching. Okay, so do you have any questions concerning these topics?